should I forgive? As many as 7 times, said Jesus. Jesus said, not just 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wishes to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii and seized him by the throat. And he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. And when his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. And then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
I almost dreaded, my problem was a translation difference, so sorry about that, but I dreaded reading that scripture out loud this morning because of that last verse. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Okay, it's out there now. That incredibly challenging news that it's not easy to talk about or think through the complexity of forgiveness, is it? Not sure if you saw the front page of the paper, I meant to bring it with me. The bottom story in there has to do with a man who was hunting with his son many, many years ago now, accidentally shot him, his 14-year-old son. And the story goes on to talk about what it has meant to live with that story, what it's meant to try to move on with his life, and in essence, to live with what he did, but to begin somehow in his life to forgive himself. I had so many stories shared with me this week that direct attention to the power of forgiveness. There was a young man who had his driver's license, got permission from his father to drive the new car. I probably don't even need to finish this story, do I? With great pride, he started driving down the street, turning on the radio, being distracted, and sure enough, he had an accident. And he began to think in his mind, what am I going to do? My dad is one of those black and white guys. It's clear when you're right, it's clear when you're wrong, and there are implications when you're wrong. He thought, I have $100, that'll pay for the accident. Wouldn't even get near it. Nonetheless, he worked in his head for the hour until his father could come to join him, and he waited in trepidation. And his father got out of the vehicle that had brought him, looked at his car with great sadness, and turned to his son, who said, Father, I have $100. I'll give it to you. I will do everything possible to pay for the accident I've caused. And his father took him and said, Son, the car can be replaced, but you can't. It's okay. My friend shared that story and said he has thought of that tale often in his life, of what it meant to receive grace upon grace from his black and white father when it came to decision making in the house. A second story. A friend discovered as she was preaching and looking out in the congregation, someone that she had known 30 years ago. This person apparently has been struck with Alzheimer's and felt a terrible need before he lost his mind to take a bus from somewhere in North Carolina to Duluth to share with this friend of long ago why things had been so terribly broken and torn apart when they parted. She saw him at the beginning of worship, went to him, and he said, "I can't talk now. I don't want to talk with you now because I know you have to leave this service, but please can we spend the afternoon together?" And thus unwound reconciliation after some 30 years. But it was important to this person, before they lost their mind, to settle accounts. And they parted knowing they wouldn't see each other or talk again, but both of them breathing in a whole new way. Stories about forgiveness and reconciliation, one that crossed years and the bounds. Several of the guys came to Jesus saying, "How many times do we have to forgive? Seven times?" And this is rich in Old Testament history that if you want to spend more time just investigating forgiveness in the Old Testament, there's lots to read, but it's rooted there. And Jesus turned to Peter and he said, "No, 70 times seven, Peter," which really, it means in terms of what Jesus is talking about, is Peter, always and forever you must forgive, always. And my response is, wow. How do we begin to put our minds around that? Because we know the situations that trip us up, that stall us, things that we wonder if we can ever, ever forgive, ever. And I know when we come into this sanctuary on Sunday morning, we need to remember what a powerful thing that we have a prayer of confession. Where else do you go in your week, in your world, in your life, where you're given a prayer of confession that enables you and me and us as a congregation to ask forgiveness to God for the things we've done or haven't done? A moment where suddenly we can clean the slate because we do believe our gracious God forgives us. Tom Long talks about this tale, the Presbyterian pastor. It's like the CEO of IBM has his clerk come to him because the clerk owes him $1 bazillion. And out of great mercy, the IBM CEO says, "Okay, I would like you to work to pay this off, but I'm not going to throw you in prison." Well, the clerk turns around to the guy who owes him rent living into his building and says, "Pay me now. Oh, and in fact, you're late. I'm arrested. Having you arrested. The police are right here. You're going to jail." Oh, the fellow workers at IBM heard about this, went to the CEO, relayed the news, and then this very hard part of the scripture. The guy that was forgiven who did not forgive is in deep trouble with the IBM CEO. And there's a confrontation, and it's not pretty. Jesus continues to wind through this, the fact that he knows people's hearts, he knows our hearts, he knows our world, and forgiveness is complex, and living together is complicated. But Jesus begins to say, "I know that, I know your hearts, but we need to talk about how we wind the practice of forgiveness into our world and into our lives. And boy, do we need that. What do you think?" We do in premarital counseling suggest those six important words: "I am sorry, I forgive you. I am sorry, I forgive you." Six powerful words, not just for marriage, but for any relationship we are in. Boy, daily, do we need to turn to each other? "Yeah, I'm a toad. And I just did a toadish thing, and I'm really sorry." Are we readily aware of the need to use that language? It's not about mathematics and transactions. If you do, then not in God's frame of reference. It's not an if and then. It's not mathematics. It's topsy-turvy on your head. We're called to forgive, and we always want to remember why. Why we hold this up, why we talk about it. May I direct you to a cross on the wall? It is the most powerful image in our lives because of the great love of God in Jesus Christ, who upon a cross said, "Forgive them." Culpability. The great words of forgiveness. So because of a sea of grace that surrounds us, that you and I float in all the time, we have to determine our relationship to forgiveness. Okay, what are some suggestions as we ruminate on this? One of the powerful stories for me was the one that came back to us from 2006 of the 5 Amish girls that were killed in their schoolhouse. The family and community gathered, and they mourned, and they wailed, and they made a decision to forgive, because daily and weekly we say this, they said, as we forgive those who trespass against us, so we too must forgive this person who has shot our children, for we are forgiven. And you know, they forgave and they were reviled. They got all sorts of notes and messages. They were really trampled upon for actually suggesting you could forgive someone that has shot your children. I have a friend who lost, yes, a beloved pet. And the anger that still resides there is because it was an awful accident that didn't have to happen. And yet the anger is there, even if it's the pet. If it's our children, anger swirls in our world, and we see from this community a suggestion that you can forgive and learn to forgive. And it's centered in this prayer that we will say in a little bit. Soon we will join together in the Lord's Prayer. Oh Lord, forgive us as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgive us, Lord. My friend said, okay, I step now out into trying on those words, "I forgive you." Oh, they don't feel very good, and sometimes I don't mean them, but I really want to say those words, "I forgive you for really wounding and hurting me because of my love for this pet." So Lewis Smeads has written a book called The Art of Forgiving. I recommend it to you. I don't know if it's in our library, but we should get it. The Art of Forgiving. What does it mean to practice? What does it mean to willingly step into situations where we have a feeling we might need to do some reconciliation, some work? Maybe it's with ourselves. I have that great serendipity prayer right here because I know this is always imperfect for me and scary for me to preach. So I keep the serenity prayer that's been on Facebook that says, "God grant me the serenity to stop beating myself up for not doing things perfectly, the courage to forgive myself because I'm working on doing better, and the wisdom to know that you already love me just the way I am." We are imperfect. We make mistakes. But the art of forgiving is a tool that you and I need to have in our basket. It's a tool that we're working on, learning to live with, ruminating on. And it says we need to try on those words, "I forgive you," and "I love you." And can we talk about this? Can I listen? Can we understand? Corrie Ten Boom, who is a woman with her sister and family, hid Jews during Nazi Germany. And they were caught for hiding Jews and imprisoned. And her sister passed away in prison. She writes this, a woman who knows how to wrestle with forgiveness and what this can mean. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. So in other words, it doesn't always feel right. We're not always convinced it's a thing to do, to forgive ourselves or to forgive you. But nonetheless, it's something to try on, and it's an action and a function of our faith to step out to be forgiving people, even when it's difficult. Now I bring us back to the Amish community because they mourned, and forgiving did not change the fact that it happened. It did not change the fact they would be in pain forever, that they had lost dear children. The pain and the despair is deep. And they did not say forgiving meant they forgot. There is, if you've heard that, oh, forgive and forget, put that one away. There's nothing about forgiveness that suggests forgetting. Because we need to learn from the things that have happened. And some are dreadful, dreadful. What do we want to say about genocide? What do we want to say about harm to women and children, to perpetrators that need to be stopped? I will not forget. I will not forget. It does say that our minds will be numb and our hearts will be broken and that God will feel this pain. But justice still needs to happen. There's a movie, Wind River, if you haven't had a chance to see it, it's in the theater. It's not easy, but it's about the terrible tragedies on a Native American reservation with the young women that just disappear and are lost. And we need to see that. We're gathering at Clayton Jackson McGee this afternoon at 4:00. If you can join me, I will be there. It's to remember once again very tragic actions in Duluth of a lynching. It's part of our history. There's complicit things that we all need to sort of think through. They're heavy and we do it slowly. But nonetheless, we don't want to forget because there are things that need to change and not happen again. Doesn't mean that we don't wrestle with saying the words, I forgive you. I like Desmond Tutu and his work in Truth and Reconciliation in South Africa. How difficult to bring victims of war in the same room with perpetrators. And the whole intent was to set up an opportunity to hear, to listen, and to speak. Judgment would be rendered in another place, but in this room, it was getting out the truth of what had happened in the lives of women and children and villages to hear, and for the perpetrator to be there to hear, to listen, possibly response. Oh, sometimes the plea for forgiveness was not heard, it was rejected. Sometimes the tears and the groans were so deep because for the very first time, victims had an opportunity to express the pain, get it out there, groan deeply, for there to be witnesses to what had happened there. When something is witnessed, something changes. When you're heard, something changes. And I think we all come, don't we, here frequently hoping and longing, just longing for the burdens, for the great things that we carry like a ball and chain in our lives to be let loose here, to be forgotten, to be untied. I know that I've come with those things in my heart, yearning for the words of forgiveness, and for others to practice those words on me as I try to practice them elsewhere. Oh, the things that we have rolling around in our hearts, that God provides a way for us to let them go. The Old Testament passage, God provided a way, a very powerful way, out of captivity and chains and burdens and illness and death. God provided a way through the waters. And God continues to provide ways for us to know that we needn't be chained and burdened. We sing that song with the Revelation group, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Now we know one moment my chains are gone and I just pick them right back up the next moment. Nonetheless, the hope and the grace and the work of Jesus is that our chains are gone and we've been set free. All those things we can build a new relationship to. We have that choice. Are we willing? Are we willing for the grace of God to work in our hearts that we might choose anew, walk a new way? So that's why we wrestle with this. And I know there's timing on all these events. I can talk about my pains from childhood now that I'm an older woman. It took me a long time. I'm not sure how I feel about reopening this story that starts tonight on Vietnam. I'm not sure I'm prepared yet to get over my anger with God over my brother's terrible experience, the terrible wounds. I was an angry 14-year-old, ooh baby. And I remember seeing him in the midst of his surgery in Georgia, legs bound up behind him because his legs had been shattered, with the hopes that they could rebind nerve cells and eventually straighten his legs out. 2 years, and I said to him in his drug-induced state, I am really angry, and I'm angry with God, and I'm so sad this happened to you. And in days, he turned to me and he said, you know what, I'm still living. There's some purpose for my life. Would you let it go? But those are the words Jesus says to us. Would you let it go, and would you make it right? We are forgiven, and that's why we wrestle with this. We are forgiven. We need to try it on. We need to give it time. May not have that much time in my life to get it on. We may choose what fire we will fuel in our lives. Will I be the angry woman, or will I fuel something else? The grace of God, the forgiveness of God. What will I fuel my life? So, God so loved the entire cosmos, every little inch, poured grace upon grace, provided a way for captives to be set free. And we're not alone. God is with us. God is our strength. The only stupendous strength that can make this possible is the love of God. John Krakauer says, when you forgive, you love. And when you love, God's light shines upon you. When you forgive, you love. And when you love, God's light shines upon you. What a wonderful and amazing thing to realize that God's light shines upon us when we do this kind of work. So our world, our community, in desperate need of these words of healing and hope. Tom Long writes in closing, we know too well that the little boat in which we are sailing is floating on a deep sea of grace, and that forgiveness is not to be dispensed with an eyedropper, but with a fire hose. Dispense grace this week. Dispense forgiveness, and God's light will shine upon you. Let's take Oh, gracious Lord, what do we say about deep love and your love for us in spite of our silliness, in spite of our wounding others and hurting and sometimes evil things we do? Help us, strengthen us, move us to be people of grace and mercy and acting it out a great, great vision of waters flowing down mightily. Help us. And we continue to give our hearts and lives to you. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Please join me in hymn number 141.